Okay, Shalom everybody. So this class has been dedicated by Leah Chusid for the honor and the sake of Chaim ben Shmuel, may peace be upon him, and to Dora Brina Miriam Bat Aliza to marry her true Zivug in the merit of Rabbi Nachman ben Fege. May they both come to what is needed, to Chaim ben Shmuel, to have peace be upon him, and Dora Brina Miriam Bat Aliza, to marry her true Zivug, Bezat Hashem. With that said, we are starting now the class, continuing the class where we left off, the Bridge Likutei Moran, lesson 66, paragraph number 10. Bezat Hashem, I really hope we will finish this lesson. But I must just give an amazing insight. on the period of time we are holding in right now, in context to this amazing lesson 66. To explain a little, there's a book called the Megale Amukot. Megale Amukot, written by a very special tzaddik, Natan Nate Shapira. He's buried in the Krakow Cemetery, not far from the Holy Rama and the Tosfot Yom Tov, few tzaddikim there, and the Bach. There, this tzaddik, Megale Amukot, he writes something amazing, that originally, Esav, his name was supposed to be Asui, with a Yud at the end. Like Rashi says, the reason why he was called Esav is because when he came out, he was completely hairy, like a grown-up man, even more. So he was complete in, like, technically the maturity of his physical body when he came out. He was so hairy. So he was like Asui, made like a complete man. So he was technically supposed to be called Asui with that Yud. However, Yaakov, the root of the name Yaakov is Ekev, which means the heel of the foot. Because he came out afterwards, he grabbed Esav and preventing him to leave first, right? Trying to hold on to him, grab onto his heel. And his doing that was that he should take away Esav's Yud. And this Yud was given to Yaakov. That's why he's called Yaakov of a Yud. And Esav is without the letter Yud. Okay? So this is why Esav hates so much Yaakov, because he wants back this Yud. But the Yud doesn't really belong to him. It belongs rightfully for Yaakov, because this Yud, if Esav would have it, he would technically destroy the world. What is this Yud? In context of what we have been learning in this class, if you remember, we mentioned that a person is supposed to bring out from potential to actual. And the potential is hinted to in Hashem's name. Okay, right? The holy four-letter name, which begins with the letter Yud. And that Yud, beginning Yud Kei Vav Kei, is the beginning of the potential of creation. When the creation came up in Hashem's primordial thought. So begins with the letter Yud. And then Hashem actually brought the creation from potential into actual existence, using finally the final name of Hashem, which is pronounced Adonai. It's spelled out Aleph, Dalet, Nun, Yud, and it ends with the letter Yud. And this letter Yud is the culmination of the whole creation of the world. That's the end. And this Yud is really connected to the beginning Yud. Like we say in the finite prayer, Lechadodi, Sof Maaseh B'machshava Tchila, the end of the action is already in the thought at beginning, at front, at first. This final Yud is really connected to the first Yud of Hashem's name, Havaya, Yud Kei Vav Kei. But the goal, what Hashem wanted, was to bring out from potential to actual, and once separated, then to bridge them. We went into this a little. There's some details I just to go over a bit. But the idea is, Hashem wanted there to be a recipient outside of him to experience his goodness. This is why Hashem created the creation. But yet, once the creation is existing, and it is technically separated from Hashem, from this being separated, to yes, recognize Hashem. So the goal is to have a creation which has been drawn out, brought out from potential to actual, to realization, and once separated, to reconnect it as separated, to separate the creation, that it's now no longer in potential existence, it actually came out, and once it's out, to reconnect to Hashem as being separated. So now Esav, if he would have the Yud, that Yud, which belongs to the final Yud of the name of Hashem, it would be very dangerous, because Esav was destined to be someone very bad, which he became in the end. And he would take the final point of creation, the actual, and not reconnect it to Hashem, not bring out the realization that Hashem is guiding the world. Rather, he would use it to get people and the whole world to run after the materialism and the separate existence from Hashem as something on its own and unique and special, and that's it, without reconnecting it to Hashem, to God. This is why, in the end, he lost out that final Yud, and it was given to Yaakov. And this is why also Esav hates so much Yaakov. And this hatred continued to Amalek, and eventually to Haman. The hatred in Haman and the hatred of Amalek basically is rooted in the hatred that Esav has towards Yaakov. So now, we learned in this lesson, we're going to see also coming up, that the way to bring out from potential to actual is specifically through having obstacles. The obstacles build the yearning, and the yearning causes the actual to exist, to bring out from potential to actual. And specifically, when a person has, like Hashem, a miniature creation, you want to create. What do you want to create? You have amazing goals and aspirations. You want to come closer to Hashem. You want to be a tzaddik. You want to learn the entire Torah. You have goals in your Yiddishkeit, in your Judaism, that you want to fulfill, to actualize. And as of yet, they're only in thought. You're thinking about them. To bring them out, you're going to need to do a lot of yearning. Because like we saw in this lesson, the yearning is what brings out from potential to actual. Hashem himself also, believe it or not, also had an expression of yearning. The expression of yearning, believe it or not, is hinted to in the Torah's depiction of the creation of the sixth day going into the seventh day of Shabbat. It says there, Vaychulu Hashamayim Ba'aretz V'chol Tzeva'am Vaychal Elokim Bayom HaShvi'i. The word Vaychal Elokim Bayom HaShvi'i translates, and the Lord finished, Vaychal, Hashem, the Lord finished on the seventh day all of the work in which he did. The word Vaychal means, number one, to complete, but also it comes from the root of yearning and pining. Kalot ha-nefesh. Kalot. Kala she'eri uvsari. It's an expression found in the Torah of yearning and pining. That Hashem himself, to finalize the creation, Vaychal Elokim b'yom ha-shvi'i, expressed his yearning on the seventh day. And by doing that, by completing the seventh day, that led to the completion of the entire creation. The whole creation was missing Shabbat. Ba Shabbat, ba Menucha, like the rabbis teach, came Shabbat, came with it this experience called rest. That Hashem, as if to say, he brought an experience of rest for himself, of ceasing activity. That's what was missing in the world. And he gave it over to the world, that the world should experience Shabbat. And the purpose of Shabbat is to let go and to remember that Hashem is the creator and he's behind everything. That was the whole goal of the creation. That's what was missing. And that was put into the ingredients of the seventh day. But to come to it, the Torah says clearly, Vaychal Elokim b'yom ha-shvi'i, and the Lord pined and yearned on the seventh day, bringing in the finalization, leading to what we said before, the final Yud of Hashem's name, Aleph, Dalet, Nun, Yud. It's a bit deep, these ideas, but more or less you have the ideas here. Okay? So now, when we want to bridge from Yud to Yud, from the first Yud of Havaya, Yud Kevavke, to the final Yud of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, the bridging is through yearning. The yearning is needed. So now, because yearning is needed, so the descendant of Esav, whose name is Amalek, his main work back then, until today, the spiritual energy, unfortunately called Amalek, his attack against Am Yisrael, the Jewish people, is specifically to stop them from yearning. This is hinted to in his name, Amalek. The Torah says his mother's name was Timna, Tav Mem Nun Ayin, and in the name Timna, you have there the root Meniot, Menia, an obstacle. That Amalek, his goal is to send obstacles to break the Jewish yearning. And he breaks the yearning in four categories, which are hinted to in his name. His name is Amalek. In Hebrew, it's Ayin, Mem, Lamed, Kuf. And the main four areas where Amalek, he attacks a person in order to break his holy yearning, is in these four categories. Ayin corresponds to the eyes in Hebrew, Einayim. That, number one, he gets people to see what they should not see. He gets people to get sidetracked and too blurred and too confused by everything they're seeing, right? So that's how he attacks with the eyes. Number two, the mem is mamon, money. He gets people sidetracked with monetary issues and difficulties to get people to forget about what they originally yearn for, to come back to Hashem and to have holy goals and aspirations and to express them in yearning and desire, to break the desire of holiness. So he attacks them with money issues, poverty, difficulties. How am I going to pay the bills? How am I going to pay the rent? How am I going to find the house, etc., etc.? Lamed is the lev, the heart. He gets people to stop yearning in the heart, because the place of the yearning is in the heart. But a person doesn't want, oh, I feel out of it, I don't really want it today. That is Amalek. And then Kuf, the final letter, is the kol, the voice. He gets people attacking them to not cry out to Hashem. Because the main weapon for anything in life, for materializing your aspirations and goals, is through prayer. And the main weapon to subdue the enemies, also to subdue Amalek and Esav, is also from the voice. Hakol Kol Yaakov. The voice is the voice of Jacob. That's our weapon to subdue the Yadayim Yedei Esav, the hands of Esav. We said, if you remember in this lesson, that the two Yuds, the first Yud of Yud Kevavke and the second Yud of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, are hinted to in the verse that we say every day in Ashrei, Poteach et Yadecha. You open your hands, right? You open your hands. Initially, the hands are together, and we separate them. And we explain how the Zohar explains this verse. Don't read, Poteach et Yadecha, open your hands. Rather read, Poteach et Yudecha, opening the two Yuds, separating the first Yud of Yud Kevavke from the second Yud of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, to bring out from potential to actual. Because when together, you don't see anything yet. Everything is still in thought. It's still in, it's only potential. It's not an actual. What's needed is to separate them and to reveal the actual from the potential. Right? So, Poteach et Yadecha. And Esav, he's after ruining the hands. That's why the verse says, Hayadaim Yedei Esav. The hands are the hands of Esav. Because he's looking to get both Yuds, take both of them. By getting the Yud of which is taken by Yaakov and having in his name Asui, he will then have access to destroying and ruining the presence of Hashem's name in the world. So basically, he's ruined the both the actual and the potential too. So that's why the hands are the hands of Esav after the two Yuds. Don't read Yadayim, but Yudayim, the two Yuds, right? Our weapon against this is our voice. And this is what Amalek tries to cool out. That's why it says about Amalek, when we see coming up in Parshat Zachor, it's Asher Karcha Baderech. He cooled you off. Cooled, kar. Kar is to cold. It's cold, cooling. He cooled you off while traveling. The Jews were on their way to receive the Torah at Har Sinai. They just left Egypt, and Amalek came to cool down the Jews' yearning and aspiration to receive the Torah, to enter the land of Israel. And so to every Jew today, your initial goals to become a good person, to be healthy, to be strong, to have always Hashem in your mind, to eat in holiness, to behave and speak properly, and to think good and everything, and to become a tzaddik and to learn Torah, all these good aspirations, Amalek comes to cool them off. So that's why he's the son of Timna. He's the one who sends obstacles. He's the obstacles themselves. And the goal of the obstacles sent by Amalek is to chill you out, God forbid, to make you cool down. And as if that's not enough, comes along Haman. Haman is very funny in the name, because Haman also translates as the manna. The manna, if you recall, is the heavenly bread. The bread, the sustenance that the Jews had in the desert, right? And the manna signifies, it's to remind the Jewish people forever that all of your sustenance comes from God. Why are you working? Not to make money. You're working for a different reason, to do rectifications. But sustenance doesn't come from your work. Sustenance comes from heaven. It's divinely ordained and providence. So now Haman comes along, and he tries to convince you the cooling off that Amalek is doing is heavenly sent. Just accept it. You don't have to yearn like you did before. Just try to be like everybody else. Cool down. Chill out. You know, you can't watch your eyes in holiness. So okay, accept it. You have monetary issues. Everyone else also is in debt and has problems, and everyone else is running after money. So what do you stick out? Be like everybody else. And also your heart, you're not burning like yearning like you originally had, and a heart to come back to Hashem. Chill out, accept it from heaven. This is the way. Look at the other Jewish people, other tzaddikim, they're also like this, as if he shows. And also the voice, Kol, you don't have to daven so much. Just talk to Hashem a few minutes a day and that's it. Why are you making such an issue to talk to Hashem? This is Haman convincing a person that the obstacles sent by Amalek are ordained from heaven. They're divine providence. They come from heaven. Just like the holy manna bread comes from heaven. Man is called min hashamayim, lechem min hashamayim, bread from heaven. So too Haman tries to convince us subconsciously, okay, you're not a tzaddik like you thought you would be after all. Just accept everything from heaven. This is a heavenly sand. This is part of the process. Accept the failure and live with it. And just accept it and be status quo like everybody else. This is Haman. So they work together, these three wicked existences, essences. Esav with his descendant Amalek, the son of Timna, and also Haman. Comes along this Shabbat, Shabbat Shkalim. And Shabbat Shkalim is the beginning of our freedom from the shackles of Haman and Amalek and Esav, because by Haman and Amalek convincing us that we don't have to be strong in our yearning, they take away the yud from Yaakov, leaving us as Ekev, only at the heel. We're at the bottom, nothing special about us. And the yud is given back to Esav. Esav is no longer Esav, he's now Asui. He's complete, he has everything. And us, we're just on the bottom, and this is heavenly sent. Accept it. Accept the failure. Accept the futility. Accept that you're doomed and there's nothing you can do about it. This is the situation of being called Ekev as opposed to Yaakov. Comes along this amazing Shabbat Shkalim. And the shekel, right? The monetary value of the shekel, the Torah teaches us, is half of the full shekel, right? The full shekel is, the Torah says, Esrim Gerah. 20 units of a monetary value called the gera, gimel resh hei. That's how the Torah calls the unit of a shekel. And half of that, that means 10 gera. Okay, so Hebrew, it's yud gera. That's the name. Rashi says the gera is a type of currency. That's the currency used by the Torah when enumerating the value of the objects, especially in this category of giving this the mitzvah that every Jew had to give a half shekel coin as a yearly token, a yearly donation to the Holy Temple. And everybody was equal. Whether you were rich or poor, everybody had to give the same amount, the half shekel, which is equivalent to 10 gerah. The word gerah is also found elsewhere in the Torah where it comes to talk about the laws of the signs of a kosher animal. If you recall, a kosher animal has a few signs that he's kosher. Number one, that he has split hooves, right? There's a split in the feet, and also that he chews his cud. And the word in Hebrew, the expression of chewing the cud is ma'ale gerah, bringing up the food. The cow, for example, he takes in the straw and the grasses that he's eating, and he initially chews it up the first stage with his teeth. It goes into one stomach, and then when ready to be further digested at the second stage, the food comes back to the area of the mouth, and he regurgitates the food, and he chews it again, and swallows it into a second stomach, where it's finally digested much more better. So now the word gera means that to regurgitate, to spit out. What the shekel, the parsha of shkalim, what the Shabbat affords us, is we're able to spit out, to get regurgitated from Esav, the Yud. The half shekel is, we said, 10. 10 is Yud. The letter Yud is the equivalent of Yud, number 10. Yud Gera, that we're spitting out the Yud that Yaakov, that Esav stole from us. The Asui, the Yud at the end of Esav, we get it back. We get it back. Why is it? Why specifically this mitzvah? Like the Torah teaches that Haman fought by donating 10,000 shekel coins to the coffers of Ahasuerus, because if you recall the story of the Megillah, that Haman offered to Ahasuerus, "Let me kill all the Jews. Let me have permission to destroy all the Jews, and to make sure that the kingdom of Ahasuerus does not lose out monetarily from the loss of so many Jewish souls, I will donate 10,000 shekel coins to the king's coffers." So there's no monetary loss. So the Torah teaches us that heaven said, "You fool, Haman. Already the Jewish people, for many, many years before your decree, while still the first temple was standing, and while the Mishkan, the tabernacle was standing in the desert, they had already given half shekel coins. Why did Hashem order that the half shekel coins be given, the yearly donation? Because he foresaw what you were going to do, and their half shekel coins already overpowered and overcame your 10,000 shekel donation that you want to give. The power of the shekalim of the Jewish people has already preceded your 10,000 shekels, which you think you can use to destroy the Jewish people." Right? So here again, we see something amazing, that the half shekel is called the half shekel. Haman, the Torah also teaches, the Gemara says, where's Haman hinted to in the Torah? It's hinted to, besides what we mentioned, the same letters as the holy manna bread, right? Haman and Haman. There's also another verse that the Torah says clearly where Haman is hinted to in the Torah. The question that Hashem asked of Adam and Eve when they ate from the tree of knowledge without permission. So Hashem asked Adam and Eve, Hamin ha'etz? Could it be that from the tree in which I told you not to eat from, did you eat? And that's why Adam and Eve, they felt they were naked. And Hashem said, how do you know what's damaging with being naked? Could it be that you ate from the forbidden knowledge fruit and thus have forbidden knowledge that I didn't tell you to have? And again, Hamin, Hamin, which is the same letters as Haman. So Haman, his ability to fool us is specifically because he's rooted and the tree of knowledge of good and bad, and using that ability, he's from the half, which is bad, of course. He's from the Etz Hadat Tov HaRa, the bad of the tree of the knowledge of good and bad. He's able to use his power of being rooted in the tree of knowledge of good and bad, and to confuse us, and making us think, like we said, it's okay, what Amalek is attacking you with, accept it, that's you. That's not from heaven, it's heavenly sent. And it's not someone else doing it. It's ordained from heaven, and just accept it. Go with the flow, right? So here comes along Haman, using his ability, being rooted in the tree of knowledge of good and bad, to attack us. For this reason, we give a half shekel, the half of the shekel that we're giving is to subdue the half which Haman is rooted in. Haman is rooted in the evil side of the tree of knowledge of good and bad. By the Jewish people giving the half shekel, we're able to subdue and bring back the tainted way of thinking that Haman is trapping us in, to bring it back into holiness. The word for shekel in Hebrew, a shekel is the name of the coin, that with the currency, right? It's called a shekel coin. But in the language of the Gemara, especially in the Gemara and the Talmud, they always use shakla vetarya lishkol, which means to remove from one place and bring it to another place. Shekel, take this item. Shekel, it's a word used in the vocabulary of the Gemara, which means to take an item and bring it from point A to point B. So the actual mitzvah of the shekel, the half shekel, is we're taking back the dot, the knowledge that Haman is tainting in our brains to convince us that it's heavenly sent. The obstacles, be dead, be cooled down, be chilled and stay that way. It's good. This is what Hashem wants. So don't try to yearn and be someone who you're not, etc. So we're able to take back this dot. That's the idea of the shekel coin specifically, the half shekel coin. So this is basically what we gain from this Shabbat. I took half hour of the class to explain this amazing point, but I had to share it with you guys to realize what we're going through now. And it's such a special time now, especially as we've just gone through the Shabbat before the month of Adar. And we're hoping desperately that we have major, major miracles on Purim. The biggest miracle is subduing these evil convolutions of Haman and Amalek and, of course, Esav, and to become who we really are. And in context of the lesson we're learning now, to realize our potential, to see our potential actualize, and not to be what's called in Yiddish a friar, not to be a chicken, not to be a nobody, unaccomplished, to realize your goals, to come to it, and it's never too late. This is not just talk, but this is reality. Rabbi Nachman is teaching us this, to live with the reality of that we can realize our goals, and any talk, any confusions that make us feel, I can't make it, I will never make it, I'm stuck in everything, you should know it's not from you, and it's definitely not from Hashem. It's only from Haman Amalek, and the mitzvah in Purim is to blot out this Haman Amalek from your mind, from your subconscious, to get out, to pass the obstacles of Amalek, to pass the brainwashing effects of Haman, and to be who you really are, and to express your yearning. So before, I mentioned the Yud, right? Now, there's an expression in Yiddish called a pintele Yid. The essence of a Jew, the life source in a Yid, in a Jew, it's called a pintele Yid. Pintele translates in Yiddish as the point of the Jewishness. And it's used to say that even the most hardest Jew and the most non-observant Jew still has within him what's called a pintele Yid. He has a Jewish spark in him that can never be erased. No matter how evil he becomes, how irreligious, no matter what bad things he may say or may do, he may do the worst things, he eats on Yom Kippur, he's against the Torah and everything, still there's what's called this pintele Yid, okay? It's called the point of holiness inside. So now in our text, the Yid, in Yiddish, it means the Jew, is very similar grammatically to the letter Yud, Yid and Yud. And pintele means the point. Now, the Yiddish expression for vowel points, when a Jewish child learns in school the vowels, especially in the, like, for example, just I'm using as an example, in the Yiddish Jewish day school systems, they call the vowels pintelech. Pintelech means points. Points is referring to the vowels. And in our context, every Jew has what's called a pintele Yid. A pintele Yid means a point of his Jewishness. And this point of Jewishness becomes expressed through what we spoke about, through the yearning. If you recall, we spoke about what the verse says in Song of Songs, Nekudot HaKasef, the points of yearning. Kasef means silver. Kasef is another term for kisufin, for yearning. Yearning has many terms in Hebrew. There's cheshek, there's ratzon, there's, like we said in the pasuk in Genesis, Vaychal Elohim kalot, kala, and is also kisufin, another term. There are many synonyms of the same idea. Each one has, of course, a different meaning. That's the beauty of the Hebrew language, that there's no two words which are the exact same. Cheshek means a type of yearning. Ratzon means another type of desire. Chitufin is pining, yearning. There's different expressions, and they have different meanings also. But they're all similar, right? So the Nikud, the Pintel Yid, the point of the Yiddishkeit of every Jew, which is rooted in this Yud found in Yaakov, this gives us our life source, and it comes out with our yearning. And when we stop yearning, we are considered like dead, God forbid. When a Jew stops yearning, he has no reason to continue to get up in the morning, to put on tefillin, to want to keep Shabbat, to want to keep kosher, to want to advance. So it's as if, God forbid, he's dead. And this is what Esav, of course, is after, to get back that yud, that he should have the yearning for other things, and take it away from the Jewish people. They shouldn't have the yearning for holiness. But this is our life source. And the way to develop it is by, yes, yearning, not listening to Amalek, not falling into the trap of Amalek, and for sure not listening to Haman, but yes, to yearn and to yearn. This is the essence of our being Jewish. The essence of our Jewishness is the yearning behind what we're doing, and enhancing and advancement of this yearning in order to advance also, to get out, to become better, to come closer. Not to get older and older, but just the opposite, to get younger and younger. Okay, I think that was just an amazing introduction. I see there's a comment here from Rav Dean Bauer. Let's see what he says. Good morning, Rabbi. Regarding seeing our potential realized, and Yehuda ben Tema in Pirkei Avot and after Amida, how do we understand Ten Chalkeinu b'Torah, our portion is what we received? How would what we receive be less than our portion? You don't have... I got that. I saw that. Thank you. We don't have a fixed portion. The chelek you have is changing constantly based on how much you yearn. The portion you get of the Torah is not fixed. It's not predetermined, okay, this person before he's born, he's only going to have this amount of the Torah, this portion of the Torah. Your yearning in your lifetime will determine how big that portion is. We're asking that we have our portion. It should be in the Torah and not other things. That's the meaning of Ten Chalkeinu b'Torah. Place our portion in the Torah and not in mundanity, in sin, in garbage, whatever. In the Torah. How much is that portion? You determine it by how much you yearn. Your yearning will determine how big your portion of the Torah is. And you can always start yearning now. It's not like preordained, predetermined, that's it, predestined. I'm stuck with this amount of the Torah. You can change it based on your yearning. I had to say all this. I had to let it out. I'm happy it's being recorded. Let us now continue with the lesson. I hope you appreciated this insight to at least give you a perspective of the time frame we are in right now as we approach the month of Adar and our mission to wipe out Haman Amalek. So let us continue. Like I said, we left off in paragraph number 10. Here we go. You're going to see it fits in so nicely now. He says like this, paragraph 10, again, lesson 66, part 1 of the Bridge Likutei Moran. Kol ha-meni'ot sheyesh la'adam, all of the obstacles that a person has. Why do you have obstacles? Why is Amalek attacking you? Why is Amalek, the son of Timna, sending you meni'ot, obstacles? What is being accomplished with these obstacles? Really, it's for the good. Kulam hem rak bishvil ha-cheshek. All of the obstacles is only for the sake of enhancing and bringing out your yearning. Yearning for good, of course. Kedei shiye lo cheshek yoter le-hadavar shebikdusha. In order that you should have more yearning and desire for the item of holiness that you seek. Kichen derech ha-adam. Because this is the way of man, of mankind. The more they prevent, right, abstain a person from a certain item, the more it's prevented from you. The person yearns more to do it. The taking away, the making it difficult, is the nature of things is to push you to want it more. Like the example Rabbi Nachman gives in the lesson, a boy, a little child, you show him a nice chocolate bar and you stick it out in front of him and he's coming to take it, and then you hide it from him, you take it away. So he yearns even more the chocolate. After seeing it, and he wants it, and then you hide it from him, he wants it even more now. Okay? So then he says like this, Al ken, kesheisha Yisraeli. So therefore, when a Jewish person, a man of Israel, tzarich lasot davar ha-tzarich lo liyaduto, has to do something for the sake of his Judaism, for the sake of his whole Yiddishkeit. Look what he goes into now. This is something amazing. Ubifrat, and in particular, kesh tzarich lasot davar, when this Jew has to do something, an item, shekol yahaduto talui bazeh, that his whole Yiddishkeit, his whole Judaism is dependent on doing this item of holiness. Look what he's going to say here. You won't even believe this, but this is what he says. Which is what? What is an item that one's whole Judaism is based on? Hainu, in other words, look at this. Linsoa letzadik ha'emet. To travel to a true tzadik. Do you hear this? Rabbi Nachman is saying something which is pretty shaking for many people to hear. But this is what he's saying. He's saying that traveling to a true tzaddik is an act, an activity, an action that one's whole Judaism is dependent upon. And why is one's whole Judaism dependent upon? Because, like we said at the beginning of this lesson, when getting close, being close to a tzaddik, being considered a student, which one of the main definition of being a student is that you believe in the tzaddikim, you're students of the tzaddikim, and thus for sure you travel to be by them in order to receive Torah and guidance from them and everything else. So you receive more than anybody else in the world from the upper spirit of this tzaddik. So that whenever this tzaddik experiences any type of passing, whether it's the ultimate example of a physical death, where the tzaddik actually passes on totally, or it's a passing from level to level, or like we say that a tzaddik purposely puts himself into shame and embarrassment, he gets his name smattered and gets a bad name, and he does it purposely in order to tap into a higher level. That's why he's accepting all these embarrassments and mockery and shame. And you are with this tzaddik when going through any of these types of examples of passing from level to level. So you gain from the tzaddik's upper spirit, which comes down to this world to boost that tzaddik to the next level, whether it's to take him away, that he now has to pass on to the next world, or whether it's to go up to another level, or whether like putting him to shame in order to pass to another level also. The disciple whose time has not yet come to leave or to advance to that higher level, that very high level, he keeps with him a light, an impression from this upper spirit of the tzaddik. And Rabbi Nachman calls this an item that one's whole Judaism is dependent upon. In the lesson itself, Rabbi Nachman says that this upper spirit of the tzaddik is connected directly to the initial Yud that we spoke about, of Hashem's name, Yud Kevavke. The light of potential is the light that this tzaddik carries with him, of the upper spirit. Every Jew has a potential. Every Jew has a little bit of a portion in Hashem's potential in creation. Every Jew is a mini creator, because his whole life is filled with from potential to actual. To realize my goal. I have a goal, not to bring it on. Another goal to realize. I want to marry, to have kids. It's one goal. Then you have children. You want to get them married and raise them. That's another goal. So your whole life, for example, is filled with potential, actual, potential, actual. But the help you need to have, that the potential should not fall into the traps of, like we spoke about, Esav, Amalek, Haman, that you can bridge strongly your potential to actual, so you won't lose your Yud, your lower point, the lower spirit, the Yud of Yaakov. You need assistance. The assistance given to us is the light of the tzaddikim. That's also the idea of Shkalim, right? Shkalim was every Jew's donation to the Beit HaMikdash, the Mishkan. And the Beit HaMikdash is the place where all the points of all the Jews were united. And the ones involved in the work of the Beit HaMikdash, the climax is the Kohen Gadol, the high priest who signifies this true tzaddik. Is the idea of the true tzaddik in every generation, is the idea of the high priest. And by every Jew giving his money, his half shekel to the temple, actually connecting everything happening in the Holy Temple, which ultimately was governed by the highest being doing the work in the temple, obviously for the sake of Hashem, and that was the high priest, the Kohen Gadol, who is representing the true tzaddik of every generation. Fine? So by you traveling to tzaddikim, the idea that Rabbi Nachman is saying here is you get enhanced, you get a double portion of his spirit, meaning you get the lower spirit that you have, that anyways is connected to the tzaddik because you're a disciple of the tzaddikim. And number two, the upper spirit that comes at the time of a passing is revealed to you. I know these ideas are a bit deep, but I assume since up to this point that we've spent a few weeks on this lesson, more or less you're familiar with these ideas. So we get an upper spirit, an upper point, and this helps the person to bridge, more than anything else, the bridge from potential to actual. It's also, by the way, the light of Mordechai. Mordechai was the antithesis, the countering force against Haman. That's why Haman could not stand him. Haman, he just wanted to wipe out and destroy Mordechai. Because Mordechai was the tzaddik who kept the Jews going. If you see in the story of the Megillah, when Mordechai's decree, Haman's decree was spread, and all the Jews were told that they're going to be wiped out, men, women, and children, you can imagine the level of futility that existed, and the Jews were in major despair. The one Jew who did not give up and got the Jews to cry to Hashem was Mordechai. Like the Midrash says and the Gemara says, Mordechai was convincing the Jews, don't give in, don't give up, use your weapon. Your weapon is prayer. I'm telling you, trust me, if you daven enough and don't give in to the fear and the phobia and the trauma generated by Haman that it's over, if you don't give in to this, we can nullify the decree. We have to do this together. So the Jewish people, many of them, the majority of them, listen to the advice of Mordechai. And like it says in the Megillah, that the Jews were screaming and crying out to Hashem, and sackcloth was given out. They were wearing mourner's clothing, and they listened to Mordechai, and they cried out to Hashem. And this was the secret to the miracle of Purim. Because the crying out of Hashem is not just crying out, help, 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 but it's crying out, expressing the yearning. Hashem, the only reason why we're suffering is because we're Jewish people. That means everything we're going through is because we are your nation. We're trying to follow your goals, your desires, your will. Everything we're doing in our existence is for you, Hashem. All we want is to serve you. And now we're being attacked by this evil Haman who wants to wipe out Jewish existence, so there's no one left in the world to continue your representation in this world, Hashem. And that's all we want ultimately, Hashem. We want to serve you. We want to be part of you. Help us now while we're being tortured, not just for the physical salvation, but the spiritual salvation, which is actually what happened, like it says in the end of the Megillah, ki emu vekiblu, that the Jews re-established their commitment to the Torah. The miracle of Purim was so great that the Jews willingly accepted the Torah. It said in last week's Parsha, Mishpatim, right? And it's also, Rashi brings it down in Parshat Yitro, that Hashem at Mount Sinai, at the beginning of the Torah at Mount Sinai, Hashem took the mountain, he lifted it up from its place, and he made the mountain go over the entire Jewish nation. And Hashem told the Jewish people, accept the Torah, or else this will be your burial place, or else you'll die right now. I will smash this mountain over all of you and you will die. So the Jews accepted out of fear, without real choice, accepted out of fear the receiving of the Torah. So it was out of fear. It wasn't out of love and wanting. With the Purim miracle, the sages teach us in the Gemara, that the Jews now accepted the Torah out of love, out of ratzon, willingly. This was the real miracle of Purim, that the enhancement of Torah commitment and becoming a better person, that's what really came out of Purim's story. That's the real miracle, visitation. But going back to what we're saying here, he calls Rabbi Nachman traveling to a true tzaddik as being an item, an example of an item that one's whole Judaism is dependent upon, and which is explained how this works with the upper spirit and lower spirit, etc. Valken, right? To be fair, so he goes on. As notnim lo lemala cheshek. When a person now has to do an item that his whole Judaism is dependent upon, which is, in other words, to travel to a true tzaddik. So, in order to do it, as notnim lo milemala cheshek, from above in heaven, they give him initial yearning to do it. You will not travel to a tzaddik unless you don't want to. In other words, the only way you will do this is if you have yearning to do so. If someone doesn't want to, you can't force them. You can't force them to do it. It has to come from them. So how does it work? Hashem gives a person a yearning for any item. You have people who look back and they say, I can't believe I did this and I did that. I don't know where I received the strength and energy to do these things. The truth is, that's right. The person didn't have alone the power to do whatever he did in life, all the good things and accomplishments. It was only from heaven they sent him such a strong level of desire and yearning that with the desire and yearning, he did break the obstacles and managed to bring out from potential to actual whatever he did. On own, he would never have been able to do it. Only heaven assisted in getting the person to want to do it. So he's saying here also, so too, to travel to a true tzaddik, they give from above to a person the yearning, the cheshek to do so. And how does heaven give a person yearning? What, it's given to him on a silver platter? And he gets it like that, undeserved? No. The yearning that they give to a person is dressed up specifically through the obstacles that they send him. The obstacle sent to prevent the person from doing it is in itself the vessel and the vehicle needed and used to bring out the person's yearning. To give him the yearning, it's sent to him in the format of obstacles. The obstacles are meant to enhance the person's yearning. Because through the obstacle, the person's yearning is enhanced, as mentioned above. Alken, so therefore, what do you learn from this? Yeda ha'adam, a man should know, she'ein shum menia ba'olam, there exists no type of obstacle in the world, no obstacle in the world, she'lo yuchal l'shabera im yetzeh, that he cannot break it unless he really wants to. If you really want to, you can break any obstacle. Because the obstacle is only for the sake of bringing out the yearning. This is the only way the yearning comes out, by sending you the obstacle. That's the only way to get you yearning. Like we said, the analogy of the child and chocolate. And when a person will have strong enough desire and yearning and pining, major pining, another format of the word of yearning, kisufin dolim, big yearnings, karaoi, as fit and proper, leze ha'esek dikdusha shetzarech lasot, matching the level of the holy item and action that you want to do, and especially for such a high item that one's whole Judaism is dependent upon, which is namely to travel to a true tzaddik. So if you have enough yearning that comes out, bevadai, and through the obstacles, of course, bevadai yizkeh legomro, you will definitely merit to fulfill and complete what you initially yearn for, the potential to bring it out to actual. Ulehotzio mikoach el hapoal, to bring out the item that you initially thought and you aspired to do, to bring it out from potential to actual. Because the obstacles sent to you whenever you're trying to do something positive, something holy, something good, all the purpose of the obstacles is only for the sake of hitgabrut ha-cheshek, to get your yearning stronger, enhanced. Because technically, You don't deserve to do this holy item with such little amount of yearning. What's needed is a high dosage of yearning in order that you should earn doing this item of holiness. Right? And it's through the yearning itself that you complete and actualize the potential, actualize your goals and your yearnings and your aspirations in life. Wow. I'd like to continue, but the next paragraph is a bit longer than this one even. I think we'll leave this for next week. And God willing, we'll see how much we can do. We're holding by paragraph 11. The final paragraph is paragraph 15. I do hope we will, God willing, have time, by at least by the end of this seminar, to complete this entire lesson. Thank you for joining the class. And of course, if you have questions or comments, please get back to me. I think you will see, like I'm seeing already, this lesson is totally amazing. It's such a concept so needed in life. And the goal is to show a person that literally you can accomplish anything if he just yearns enough. And of course, you need to be guided to know what to yearn for. But yearn for good things that you know and you feel and understand that this is something that has to be done. And the obstacles are just mounting from everywhere. For example, somebody yearning to come to visit the Holy Land, or like we said in this lesson, to travel to Tzaddikim. Some people don't even yearn yet. They don't know that you should even yearn for such an item. What do I need this for? And here he's teaching what a person gains from it. Thank you for joining. Thank you, Beryl. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, RLV. Thank you, Pamela Stoneman. Rizat Hashem. Here's my email address for anyone who wants to reach out or comment or ask questions on this lesson. Meirie, M-E-I-R-E, at Breslov, B-R-E-S-L-O-V.org. Have a great week. Joy in Adar, what a name. Thank you, Shavua Tov. Yes, prayers for Rabbi Kramer's daughter. Thank you very much. We hope that Hashem, she should have major, major Purim miracles also, God willing. Thank you, Isabella. All the best, everybody. Have a great week. And Chodesh Tov, Thursday and Friday, Rosh Chodesh, all the best. Thank you, Mr. Dinberg. Only good.